Here's an example of why you don't trust good speakers with a cheap stereo system. This is actually a home theater system by RCA. It has a built-in DVD player, AM/FM radio tuner, and an amplifier with Dolby Digital and Dolby Pro Logic surround sound, which is the reason why I picked it up. I did get it with the remote. At the store, I did plug it in and turn it on, and it does power up. The display works, and the tray for the DVD opens and closes. There it goes. So that's all working. I can switch over to the tuner here. If this thing would actually listen to my button pushing here. Come on, there you go. So it does have a built-in radio tuner. But I didn't have any speakers on hand to test it at the store. And so I picked it up anyway. And then when I brought it home and I looked up the model number online just to see the specs, I saw that every single review of this model, people either said it didn't work right out of the box or it only worked for a short time and it started making loud popping sounds from the speakers. It's the model RTD325W. RCA claims it's rated for 250 watts total output power, but that's obviously all the channels combined. It has these really tiny speaker outputs for front, left and right, center channel, subwoofer, and surround left and right. And they're rated at 4 ohms for the main speakers and 3 ohms for the subwoofer. You get an HDMI output for the DVD player, as well as component and composite, and left and right aux input. And here's the AM and FM antenna terminals. And considering how light this thing is, I mean, it's barely even any heavier than a standard DVD player, and how the small that heatsink is, I knew it had to be using a Class D amplifier. Now, most of those are rated for around 20 to 25 watts per channel, but considering that this one has speaker outputs rated for 4 ohms and a subwoofer output rated at 3 ohms, they're probably using a lower impedance on the speaker outputs to get more output power, which is going to be pushing that amplifier chip rather hard, probably right up to its limits, which could explain the high failure rate for these. But even after seeing those bad reviews, nonetheless, I decided to connect it to a cheap pair of speakers, because these happen to be the only speakers I have rated at 4 ohms. So I connected them to the front, left, and right outputs, and I turned it on, and I got no audio. Even with the volume turned all the way up, absolutely no sound coming out of it. So I decided to see what was going on with my multimeter here. This is one of those freebies from Harbor Freight. So I have it connected to the front, left output, and I'll turn it on. And it briefly spiked up to negative 4 volts, but now it's going back down to 0. So that's no big deal. In fact, that's pretty typical voltage when there's no audio coming out. Just a little bit of residual voltage coming out of those speaker terminals. And the front right output is the same, just barely anything coming out of it in terms of voltage. So then I connected my multimeter to one of the surround outputs, and look at this. Almost negative 20 volts coming out of the speaker terminals. And it's the same thing with all the speaker outputs except for the front, left, and right. Right now I have it hooked up to the subwoofer output, and again, almost negative 20 volts coming out of it. So I'm lucky I didn't have any speakers connected to the surround outputs. Otherwise, if I had left it on for any length of time, I surely would have blown those speakers. Now, I don't know why the front outputs don't have that same negative 20 volts coming out of them. My guess is that either it has some kind of protection circuit only for the front speakers, or maybe it's using a separate amplifier chip for the front speakers compared to the other speakers. But either way, it's definitely a common failure with this model with the amplifier chip. And it's a shame because it's not even that old. May 2011 was when this one was manufactured. Here's a look inside. It's pretty much all surface mount parts, so definitely not meant to be repaired. Although some of the power supply components are regular through-hole components, so that would be pretty easy to repair, but that's not the failure on this one. Even the capacitors look fine, but it's the amplifier chip under here that's broken. A lot of capacitors on its output. I think because Class D amplifiers have a rather dirty output, needs a lot of filtering to remove harmonics. And you can see the subwoofer output has bigger capacitors than all the rest of them. There's some interesting rework on this chip here. Apparently it needed more capacitors, so they just decided to solder them on top of it. Otherwise it's all highly integrated. I don't even see any tuning coils for the AM tuners, so I don't know how well that would work. Unless this is the AM coil, but doesn't have any trimmer on it, so how would you adjust it? Yeah, that's the AM antenna input right there, and it just goes right into the circuit board here. And everything about this is very cheap and flimsy. You can see I've just, the pressure of holding it up on the power cord here bent the little metal part here inwards. And this case is really flimsy too. So, but that's what you would expect from a home theater system that sold for $99. At Walmart, including speakers. Here's a look at the front panel display, if I can get my angle just right. It's designed for some features that this one doesn't have. Like there's a indicator over there, I don't know if it's gonna come into focus or not. But it says USB, and this one does not have any kind of USB port. And next to the Dolby Pro Logic indicator, it has a 2 symbol. But as far as I can tell, this one was not designed to support Dolby Pro Logic 2, so that would have been a higher end model, if you can call it that. There's also a Dolby symbol of VS next to it. I don't know what that means. And there's a little ST indicator for FM stereo reception. And there's not even a headphone output on this thing, although you do get a line-in jack on the front panel. So needless to say, this will be going to the electronics recycling center, and to prevent anyone else from trying to use it and possibly burning out their speakers, I'll just cut off the power cord. That's usually what ends up happening to electronics that get left at the recycling center because of the people who go around cutting off power cords just so they can recover the few cents of copper that's in them. But this time, I'll save them the trouble. Although the remote control is working fine, so in case anybody needs one of these RCA remote controls, just let me know. Even came with batteries, which are probably the ones it originally came with when it was new. Some kind of no-name PK cell batteries. Super heavy duty, so they're not even alkalines.